We wanted to take just a minute before we have more of a ministry time, but I wanted to just share a little bit about the heart behind our band, who we are. I'm sure most of you guys aren't familiar with us. We live on the West Coast and pretty much spend the majority of our time on outside of the country. But we're called Esther Lynn. Some of you guys might have thought we were a girl band, but we are not. The name Esther Lynn comes from my little niece, who was adopted from China by my sister and her husband. Her name is Esther Lynn. And she is just the sweetest little girl. Her story is this. At 8 days old, she was abandoned by her birth parents. They left her on a porch. Someone found her, they took her to an orphanage, and now through God's providence, she's a part of my family. And she really is just the sweetest little thing. It's amazing to see in such a short time how God has already worked in her life and through her life in really amazing ways. And God has used the whole experience to really just confirm to me the power of His love to change a person's life and how there's nothing like it. James 1:27, it says that pure and undefiled religion before God is to visit the orphans and the widows in their time of need and to keep ourselves unspotted from this world. And you know, that verse is really just jumped out to me because it's so crystal clear what God's plan, what His desire is for our lives, what pure and undefiled religion before Him is. For those of us here tonight who call ourselves Christians, that means that we're followers of Christ. And really, He could have said anything. He could have said, you know, pure and undefiled religion before me is to go to church, to give a lot of money, to sing songs, to read your Bible, to say your prayers. And those are all great things that we should be doing as Christians. But often, those are the things that we think of when we think of being religious or living, you know, religious life, spiritual life. But Jesus says specifically, pure and undefiled religion before me is to help the helpless. It's to do something for someone who can't do something for themselves. It is to find those who have been forgotten, those who have been left, those who have been alone, those who are ostracized, those who are forgotten. Find those people and show them my love. That is true Christianity. Because ultimately, isn't that what God has done for us? The Bible says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. You see, none of us have earned or deserved salvation. The Bible says that specifically that God has adopted us into His family. He has brought us into His family to show us love, to be our Father, to be our provider, to be our protector. That's what God has done for us. And He so desires that we would do the same in this world. The Bible says, what does it profit a person to love someone who loves you? That's easy. The Bible says even the sinners do that. But we are called to love those who don't love us, those who don't know us, those who can give us nothing in return. That is true love, to love your enemies, to do good for those who don't even know anything about you. We can never do anything for you. I want more of that in my life because I've seen the power of it displayed in real life, and I'm sure all of us have, in so many ways, to see the transforming power of God in a person's life, of His love. And I just want more of it. I want to share a story with you that I know will encourage you, because it's just amazing. It's amazing to see what God will do with a person who gets to that place where they say, you know what, my life is not my own. My life is not just about me living comfortably. My life is not about me just, you know, fulfilling my own dreams and my own goals, but rather my life is like Jesus' life. I want to become the least of these. I want to love. I want to serve. I want my life to bring value to others, not just value for myself. And when we get to that place of true surrender, it's amazing our lives. It's unbelievable. You see, my sister and her husband, when they adopted little Esther Lynn, they already had two of their own kids. They would have never guessed that it would lead them to adopt again 2 years later. They adopted a little boy. They named him Hudson, after the great missionary to China, Hudson Taylor. Not long after that, one day, little Esther Lynn, she was just 3 years old, she came up to my sister. She said, "Mommy, I have a little sister who lives in China. Her name is Bella, and we need to get on an airplane, and we need to get her. Can we go?" This was just out of the blue. Now, obviously, this wasn't, you know, her physical sister. She doesn't even know she has a sister. She was left at 8 days old, but this was something crystal clear in her heart. And my sister said, "Okay, honey, well, let's pray for her." So they sat down together, and they prayed for this little girl that she called Bella. Well, it really didn't make sense. Because every single day for 3 months, she just kept saying, "Mommy, when are we going to go get her? When is she going to come home?" And so they just started praying for this little girl every day. Well, at the end of that 3 months, my sister gets a phone call from one of her friends. She said, "Sarah, you've got to check out this adoption agency." She opened up a link to find there was a little girl up for adoption from China. She was 3 years old, and her name was Bella. She was like, "What? This is crazy. Because first of all, little girls in China, they're not named Bella. They're named like Yaya, you know?" And little Esther Lynn came over to that computer. She looked at the screen, and she said, "Mommy, that's my sister." And they just started crying. "What? This is crazy. We already have 4 kids. We weren't planning on adopting. We do not have $35,000 laying around anywhere. But obviously, God, you're moving. You're working." So they called the adoption agency. They said, "Can you tell us about this little girl?" I said, "Yeah, her name's Bella. She's missing 3 of her fingers, but she's just the sweetest little thing. And there's actually 2 families that have already been waiting to adopt her." He said, "Well, that's awesome that she has a family. We've been praying for her." And they just left it at that. A little confused. Well, my sister gets a call 2 weeks later from that same agency. They said, "Sarah, we don't know what happened. It looks like both families actually decided to move in a different direction. You told us that story. We had to call you and just see if you guys would be open to adopting Bella. But the catch is, you seriously have to make a decision in the next 24 hours. And so now, just about 3 years ago, Bella is a part of our family. Isn't that amazing?
Are we people here tonight that are willing
alone and forgotten, ostracized, are we willing to be that conduit of God's love? Because many of us aren't. Many of us as American Christians, what we long for is comfort. And we want the pastor and the missionaries and the spiritual people to go out there and to do the work. And we just want to tithe and kick back and, you know, watch American Idol or something. But that's not Christianity. Christianity is to love God, to be loved by God, and then to love people. And I want to be a part of that. I want you guys to be a part of that. Because it's awesome. There's nothing like it than to be a conduit of God's love to this world. You do not have to adopt someone from across the world to make a difference with your life. There's people right here in your community. We're going to be hearing about an awesome ministry here in a few minutes that is rescuing people, that is sharing God's love in a practical way. You know what? There's nursing homes here. I'm sure there's people in prisons. There's all kinds of people who need love. There's all kinds of people who have been forgotten. There's people in your own families who feel alone. There's people all around us. So I share all of that to say, let's expect great things from a great God. Let's be willing as a family, as a church, as individuals, to say, you know what, I don't want to waste my life just living for myself. I want to see, God, what you can do. And the amazing thing is, you never know where he'll take you. But it's probably not going to be what you thought. I would have never guessed in my life, that my wife and I, that we would adopt a little boy 2 years ago from China. He was five years old when we got him. He lived in a crib his entire life. He can't walk. They don't exactly know why. But he's in a wheelchair. And that wasn't on my, docket before I got married. And they said, hey, you know what, I want this many kids. I want to adopt a special needs kid. I want to do this. I want to do that. I was like, no. But I will say that I've always tried to be open and willing to say, you know, God, lead me. Lead our family. What is it that you have for us? We were able to go back just 8 months ago and adopt his best friend that he grew up with, a little five-year-old who has Down syndrome, who is just the cutest little kid you've ever seen. And he's just full of so much joy. And I'm so thankful that I get to be their dad. And I'm not saying this to you because I'm some special person that's doing these great things, because I'm not. I'm just a regular person who messes up like all of you, that just wants my life to make a difference and wants our family to make a difference. Just gotta be open. Just gotta be willing. And so as we play this next song, I would encourage you guys to just open up your hearts. Just to say, God, how can you use my life in a greater way to show your love? And then you're gonna hear about an awesome ministry that you can partner with and be a part of. So I wrote this song about my little niece. It says that God's a father to the fatherless, that he's a healer of the brokenness, and that he makes beauty from the ashes.
Of fire for the hopeless. You. You. Thank you.
coming out here tonight. We know most of you probably have never heard of us, and so it's great that you guys all came out and desired to worship with us. I know there's many things that you could be doing on a Saturday night, so props to you. And we just want to let you guys know, we are a ministry before we're a band, and so we just want to just give you an opportunity that if there's anything that we could personally just be able to pray with you guys about, this is the only reason why, you know, we're away from our homes and our families and all that stuff. It's not so that you guys will think we're cool or so that you buy our t-shirts. We know we're not cool. People don't buy our t-shirts. We really just want to be here to minister. And so if there's a way that we can pray for you guys, to encourage you or just talk to you about life, please let us know. That's why we're here. And so I just want to make ourselves available. And also, we do want to let you know we do have some CDs and t-shirts. And we don't want to fly home with them, but we're going to. If you don't like our music at all, we do have a little toll, creating like a toll fund. This is crazy. We don't have to pay to drive over on the West Coast. You guys literally would save thousands of dollars a month by just moving over that side. Because you just drive. And you don't pay people to drive. So that's interesting. But I like it. So anyways, we're going to close with one last song. Why don't we all stand together? Thank you so much for coming out tonight. We're going to ask for a little bit.
Oh, my soul. Oh Lord, how great it is to join our hearts together in praise and worship. We thank you for this evening, and we thank you for Luke and Josh and Stephen, and we pray for them and for their families as they minister to others and are away from them. Please bless them and keep them and get them home safely too. Father, get us home safely as well, we pray, and give us good rest for your day tomorrow, we ask. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks so very much for coming.
Charged to do so. And also, how on earth could kids
kids.
Grow up to be fully realized adult Christians if they spend their lives serving someone else. So Araminta accomplishes this through, well, what I call our aim. Our aim, our mission is to awaken, equip, and mobilize. I'll speak about each of those in turn. And the reason why I'm speaking to you specifically is the power of the church. Throughout history, even with the abolition of American slavery, we've seen the church work wonders. The church is the backbone of so many grassroots movements in this country that it would just be foolish to overlook the power and influence that we all have as believers. Bear with me for a moment. I want to actually read this entire quote to you because I think it's that important to hear. So, there's nothing like the local church when it's working right. Its beauty is indescribable. Its power is breathtaking. Its potential is unlimited. It comforts the grieving and heals the broken. Whatever the capacity for human suffering, the church has a greater capacity for healing and wholeness. Still to this day, the potential of the local church is almost more than I can grasp. There's simply no other organization on earth anything like it. And when I say church, I don't mean just the global church, but every single one of you right here. Because Araminta is a local organization. Araminta is a local organization aiming to end child trafficking, not globally, but within Maryland, within our lifetime. And so with the people here in this room, with the other volunteers like myself and Becky Brennan, who you might have met earlier, I think that's quite possible, quite achievable. There are a lot of misconceptions out there about human trafficking. Most people think that it's something happening in other countries. It's a problem in Asia, Africa, Europe. But very few people realize how many children are either trafficked or at risk for trafficking right here in the U.S., right here in Baltimore. Baltimore specifically because, well, it's a port city. Second, we have a number of amazing pro sports teams. And whenever you have large entertainment venues, human trafficking comes along with it, unfortunately. But lastly, and this is a problem that's made the front pages of the news recently, there's great disparities of wealth and poverty. And we've learned at Araminta that whenever you find that sort of checkered relationship where extreme wealth and extreme poverty are so close together, there's a possibility and a likelihood that the weak will be preyed on. The poor will be preyed on. Now, this is a difficult thing to talk about because it's so unimaginable to me. But it's the reality of some children's everyday life. When we spoke to some of the minors that we've rescued from child trafficking, they reported entering into it ages as early as 9 and 7, but on average around 12, 13. Now, 12 or 13 is below the working age for everything. But if someone spends a lifetime in bondage, that's what you resolve with. That's the result. second largest criminal activity because of the sheer number of working years that each trafficked child can produce. And so, in the U.S. and internationally, we understand drugs are a tremendous problem and there's a tremendous amount of focus on it. But something that so personally affects every single person in this room, that could affect every grandparent, every parent that you know, doesn't get nearly as much attention. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release from darkness for those prisoners, to comfort all who mourn, and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. When I read scripture like this, it erases any doubt in my mind that we as the church have a role to play in delivering freedom. It reminds me that God isn't simply or just a God of love, but God is a God of mercy, compassion, redemption, salvation. And as the church, we're working to build this kingdom of God. And Araminta is working hard to do so, but we need your help. So this is the point where everyone usually is thinking, this is a really big problem. What on earth can I do with one person? The answer is there's plenty. So, first, support. You can go online to our website, aramentafreedom.org, and download a prayer guide. We want your prayers, your thoughts. We want your support. Also, right now, Araminta, as fast-growing and successful an organization as they are, is supported solely on charitable donations. And so, any generous gifts, offerings, donations that you can make are also greatly appreciated. Second, involvement with your local politicians, congressmen, council members. Araminta has a legislative body that keeps their finger on the pulse of local, statewide, and national legislation that can make it easier for us to end human trafficking, specifically child trafficking. And so, whenever one of these bills is on the table, we want each and every one of you to give your representative a call and let them know that you know about this issue, that you care, and that you want them to take action on it. Because it's serious, it's urgent, and that's actually one of the most effective ways to move their hands. Second, it's important for us all to learn. I'm here to just introduce Araminta and our mission and purpose this evening, but there's so many more opportunities for you to learn about human trafficking and Araminta. For instance, there are dozens, maybe hundreds, of child trafficking websites and resources on the Araminta website, aramentafreedom.org. Go ahead and check it out. Tons of information, videos, and it's all very accessible. You can learn a lot in a matter of minutes. Also, I encourage everyone to, well, study. Don't take my word for it, and these two scriptures I've read. Open up your own Bible with this in your mind and heart, and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. I'm I'm certain will reveal to you why you need to take up this charge. Airmen also has several presentations and trainings throughout the year for people who want more information, whether it's to spread that information and share it with friends, family, co-workers, whether it's to teach, whatever. Every single person in this room has some talent that if they learn more about Araminta, about child trafficking, and this grand problem in Baltimore and Maryland, they can lend that talent in an effective way to make a difference. Lastly, volunteering. Araminta has a swath of different volunteer opportunities. An active, engaged Bible study, a prayer group, an education team, and also a survivor support group where they offer mentorship and support to young women and young girls who've been rescued from this bondage, which is a very important step. And so, if you have any inkling to volunteer to advance this mission that I'm speaking about tonight, I strongly encourage you to get in contact with myself, Becky and Matt. You can go online to the website, and someone will reach out to you once you give your information, or call the main administrative number that's on the handouts that we have in the back of the church. Remember, darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Another reason why the church involvement is so critical to this movement. It's not just the work of Araminta volunteers, but very much the light, good, and love of God that can rescue and deliver these young people. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand. And it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. This church is the light. Each one of you are lights. God and His Son, whose example we're following by taking on this mission, is the light that will lead us and those young people to freedom. And so, I want to conclude with special thanks to God for bringing together this very special group of people tonight. My ability to have this moment with you and your attention. And I also give thanks to anyone who will carry this information, this new knowledge outside of these doors and further our mission. That's the very least I ask for, and I'm very thankful for everyone who does so. Thank you so much again for your time, and I've really enjoyed, this is my first time visiting Lock Raven Presbyterian, really enjoyed my time here. Thank you for excellent worship services and style. I think I'll come back, actually. So thanks again for your attention, and here's Pastor Milligan.
Thank you, Michael, for that information. Brothers and sisters in Christ, we cannot claim ignorance any longer. Get the information, please, and we're going to take a few moments now to have a free will offering. And And the entire offering is going to Araminta Freedom Initiative. The church has taken care of any costs. Please give freely. Give as the Lord leads. And if you can't give tonight, get their address. Go online. Support this work in our region, please. Before we give, let's offer this time to the Lord. Our Heavenly Father, you did rescue us. For we were captive to sin. Our hearts were slaves to Satan. And you set us free. Your Son has delivered us out of the kingdom of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of light. And you have made us light because your Holy Spirit is within us. Oh, Father, please, let us not hide our lights, but instead shine and shine together. Thank you for this time tonight that we can join together in praying that you would bless this ministry, Araminta Freedom Initiative. Bless their efforts and save the children. Everyone else affected by this. Lord, may your holiness be made known through our lives. And Lord, we thank you for this opportunity, for what a wonderful privilege it is to give to your kingdom's spread and gospel growth. And we ask that you would bless all we give tonight and bless us as